This Tuesday lunchtime. Online booking for hotel quarantine system opens. Health Minister says it should deter foreign travel.
It's a strong measure. Ireland is taking a leading role, or the leading role, in the European Union on this.
10 people, including a policeman, are killed in a mass shooting at a Colorado supermarket. And pubs and restaurants warn of permanent closures as they await the go-ahead to reopen. Mandatory hotel quarantine will come into force this Friday. Anyone travelling into Ireland from 33 at-risk countries or without a negative PCR test must pre-book and prepay their accommodation on the online booking system, which is now up and running. The Minister for Health said the regime should help to deter foreign travel into the country, but the critics say it's inadequate.
The booking portal for mandatory hotel quarantine went live this morning. Anyone travelling into Ireland from 33 designated countries must pre-book their accommodation and prepay. The rules also apply to all passengers arriving from non-designated countries without a negative PCR test before departure.
Ireland is the first country in the EU to bring in anything at this level. It's now the most comprehensive system of hotel quarantine anywhere in the European Union by a long way. Very importantly, it means that the UK and Ireland are now very closely aligned on this, and this is important. Ireland and the UK now have some of the lowest COVID rates anywhere in Europe. It allows us to protect the progress that's been made.
The first hotel that will be available is the Crowne Plaza Dublin Airport Hotel in Santry. The Tifco Hotel Group will provide full board accommodation along with transportation, security, health and well-being services. 12 nights in quarantine will cost one adult in a room €1,875. A day rate for passengers waiting on a test result is €150.
What is being put in place at this moment in time is an abject failure. It will not work. There are too many loopholes. So if people are flying in from South Africa through London, if they don't declare, if they're on a different passport, we won't know. So unless you self-declare in most situations because of the lack of direct flights, this will not work. And the reality is we should have mandatory hotel quarantine for everyone, bar essential workers.
While we do acknowledge the fact that now 33 countries have been added to the list, we simply don't see it as being enough. We see issues that emerge in Australia in relation to ventilations in hotels, in relation to private security, and we seem to be replicating them here.
The new rules come into effect from 4 a.m. on Friday. Anyone who doesn't comply can be fined up to €2,000 or face a prison sentence of up to a month. Diane Connor, RTE News.
Well, let's talk to our political correspondent, Paul Cunningham, now who's at Leinster House. Paul, as we heard, there plenty of criticism about this system. Is the government confident then that this will deter foreign travel into this country?
The government always points out that an awful lot of foreign travel has simply disappeared, more than 95% if you compare it year on year. They do truly believe that measures like this will deter travel. The very idea that someone would have to spend €1,800, even more if they're travelling with a partner or with kids. But you get the sense from the opposition, it's pretty clear that they don't believe this is going to work. The People Before Profit TD, Paul Murphy, saying it was next to useless. He said that only 10% of passengers engaging in non-essential travel, in his view, would be covered by the 33 countries where this particular mandatory hotel quarantine is going to apply. So there's an awful lot more to go, and we still have to dig into the detail of exactly how it's going to work.
Separately, Paul, today the Cabinet is expected to approve the Climate Action Bill, which is a ramped up version of the original bill. What's expected to be in that?
Well, in breaking news, Eileen, I've just heard that Cabinet has actually approved the Climate Action Bill that's gone through Cabinet just in the past couple of minutes. As I understand it, there are three key things. One is that Ireland is going to aim to be carbon neutral by the year 2050, that they will have interim targets, and that by 2030 more than 50% of greenhouse gas emissions have to be cut, and that the plan is going to be aligned with the Paris Climate Change Accord. That's the international agreement. Now, as it understands, the Green Party feels that this is a particularly particularly hardening of wording which had been in the draft deal. They think that it's a very good agreement. Opposition parties say they want to see the actual document itself, and they're also concerned about just how effective it's going to be. Will it actually do what it says it's going to do? Here's a flavour of what people have been saying.
Charts a course to where we get rid of the pollution, the climate pollution currently happening. Take 30 years. The first 10 years we aim to halve it. And that's a huge change, but it's a change for the better.
We can argue about the ambition, they should go further, but for us, really, it is that they have to be implemented. So yes, we could know more ambition, but as I said, you could have 2025 and nothing happens. So for us, it's about the accountability and the corrective mechanism.
As I say, I haven't seen all the detail, but from what I understand, this is massively less than what is required and what was promised by the Green Party.
So there's not going to be consensus on this particular one. That's absolutely clear. What we'll be looking to this afternoon when the bill is actually published is just how does it deal with certain sectors, say like agriculture. That'll be key to understanding just how far the government has moved.
OK, Paul Cunningham, thank you. Now, the HSE has said that it will be the end of the year before cancer services are fully restored in the wake of the COVID pandemic. The commitment is made in a plan to resume health services in three phases between now and December. It also aims to have outpatient clinic levels restored between July and September ahead of full restoration of planned operations. Well, let's talk to our health correspondent, Fergal Bowers, who's at the Department of Health. Fergal, a lot of concerned cancer patients wondering when their care can get back to full capacity. When can we expect that to happen?
Well, obviously, all of this is contingent on no further surges and no surprises in this HSE plan. But in relation to cancer services, they're to be fully restored by the end of this year. Reduced capacity for cancer services will continue during March and up to June. And then 90% of capacity will be restored between July and September for breast check, cervical check, bowel screening and diabetic retina screening. Outpatient clinics are due to be fully restored between July and September, and planned operations and day cases, they're supposed to be fully restored by the target period between October and December. This plan says that the potential demand for COVID-19 ICU beds should end up being about 50 or less from April 5th, and in terms of general beds, the demand for COVID-19 patients should be about between 100 and 270 if everything goes to plan.
Looking at the vaccination rollout, Fergal, NPHET has been giving some details about when people aged 70 and over will be vaccinated. What's the latest on that?
Yeah, this is the latest published letter from NPHET to the Minister for Health, and it notes that people aged 70 and over will not have received their first dose of vaccine until after mid-April, and that they won't have got their second dose until after mid-May. And in this letter, NPHET highlights the potential vulnerability of this group over the coming months. Now, you'll recall that in mid-February, the Minister for Health said it would be mid-May before all those aged 70 would be fully vaccinated. And today the minister said that any of all those dates on vaccination that are given, that they're conditional on the pharma companies delivering on their vaccines, and that the task force is looking constantly at these vaccination dates.
All right, Fergal Bowers, thank you. Staying with vaccinations, and the European Medicines Agency says it hopes to be able to approve the Russian Sputnik V vaccine for use in Europe's vaccine rollout. The EMA's executive director told a European Parliament committee that she hoped the vaccine would be a valuable addition to the EU's portfolio of COVID-19 vaccines.
We have accepted a rolling review from on the Sputnik vaccine. We are in the process of evaluating. We are in the process of organizing inspections. We do hope that this will be a valuable vaccine to add to the vaccines that are available from the European population, and that it will get authorization at a European level based on the same standards of safety, quality and efficacy that we apply for every vaccine.
In the United States, a mass shooting at a supermarket in Boulder, Colorado, has left 10 people dead, including the first police officer to arrive on the scene. A suspect injured in the attack has been arrested and is being treated in hospital.
Police moving in on the King Super grocery store in Boulder County following reports of an active shooter. Terrified shoppers and staff were escorted from the building before a man with a bloodied leg was seen being detained and led away in handcuffs. Police did not identify the suspect, but said he was being treated at a local hospital.
Our hearts of this community go out to the victims of this horrific incident. We know of 10 fatalities at the scene, including one of our Boulder PD officers by the name of Eric Talley.
The actions of the 51-year-old father of seven, who had been an officer for over a decade, were hailed as heroic. A procession of his colleagues and first responders saluted as his body was taken from the scene by ambulance. Work is underway to identify all of the other victims. Shoppers who fled from the attack, clearly shocked by what they had seen.
It was definitely panic. I think a lot of people just didn't know like exactly where he was or where he was going to be.
And he started running and then he shot towards us we could feel it and we just kept going. We just ran and there was somebody laying in the road.
Following a lull in shootings during the pandemic, this bloodshed marks the second deadly U.S. mass shooting in a week after eight people died at three locations in and around Atlanta last Tuesday. Eleanor Burnhill, RTE News.
Back home, two men have been before a court charged with the murder of Alan Hall, who was attacked in his home in Dublin last May. 30-year-old Derek Cody from Nugget Cottages in Bluebell and 34-year-old Connor Curran from Drumcara Grove in Talla were also charged with arson with intent to endanger life.
Detectives from Blanchardstown brought the two men to court this morning, charged with arson and murder. Derek Cody and Connor Curran were arrested last night in connection with the murder of Alan Hall, a father of two who previously worked as a butcher and lived alone in a bungalow on Bluebell Avenue in Dublin. His body was discovered here at his home after the fire brigade arrived on the 18th of May last year. The 44-year-old had been attacked and an attempt had been made to set fire to the scene. Two detectives gave evidence of arrest charge and caution in court today. They told the court that Derek Cody, who's unemployed, made no comment when he was charged with the two offences last night, while Connor Curran, who's a self-employed construction worker, was arrested in Cork City at 7 o'clock last night. When he was charged with the two offences at Clondalkin Garda Station 3 hours later, he made no reply. There was no application for bail, as bail cannot be granted in the district court on a murder charge. However, defence solicitors told the court that both men will be applying to the High Court for bail. Judge Gerard Jones remanded both to appear again by video link at Clover Hill Thursday. He also directed that Derek Cody receive medical attention as required during a mandatory 2-week COVID isolation in custody. Paul Reynolds, RTE News, Blanchardstown District Court.
It's been claimed that half of restaurants could face permanent closure in the wake of the coronavirus pandemic. The Restaurants Association of Ireland, which is appearing before an Oireachtas committee this afternoon, is calling for a number of measures to help the sector, including retaining the reduced VAT rate for hospitality until 2025. The bodies representing the pub sector say there must be no distinctions between bars serving food and those that do not.
Additionally, we need a clear statement from government that all hospitality outlets will be allowed to open at the same time, under the same conditions, and subject to the same sanctions. No more divides between food and non-food. I repeat, no more divide between food and non-food.
Well, Mary Regan of our political staff is standing by now. Mary, as we heard, there are many pubs and restaurants just won't be reopening after all of this. What are the main demands now for the sector as they prepare for any kind of reopening?
Yeah, well, these businesses before the committee today, they're businesses that mostly haven't traded for most of the past year. Some, namely those pubs in Dublin, haven't opened their doors for 372 days. So they're painting a picture of an industry really deep in crisis. They're talking about job losses, about financial loss and the impact and the toll this is all having on mental health. And they are making some key demands, which they say will ensure their viability into the long term. Now, one of them is around clarity around when they can reopen. Now, they're saying they understand the government can't give them exact dates at this point in time, but they want an outline of the circumstances that will allow them to reopen. For example, how many people or what percentage of the population should be vaccinated, what level of community transmission would be acceptable to allow them to reopen. And they also want clarity on whether people should have to prove or not that they were vaccinated before being served as customers in the hospitality sector. For the longer term, they're looking for a number of issues. One is the continuation of the wage subsidy scheme for a period of at least a year after they reopen. And another is the VAT rate of 9%. They want that to be retained right up until 2025. And they want the employment wage subsidy scheme also to continue for some time and for local authority rates to be waived, to be continued into the future. So these are the key demands that they're looking for before the committee this afternoon, but discussions around them will continue with the government in the months ahead.
Okay, Mary Regan, thank you. Now, the National Ambulance Service has apologised to the family of a 17-year-old student who died after a delay in attending a medical emergency caused by his diabetes in 2010. An inquiry set up after an anonymous complaint to the HSE found a number of serious failings and breaches of protocols in the response of the ambulance service. The family of Darren Gohan from Killure, Clare in County Sligo settled their High Court case against the HSE and welcomed the apology.
The Gohan family have been through a harrowing ordeal. Their son Darren had just started college at Limerick IT and he was just days away from his 18th birthday. Darren was in excellent health, but he had diabetes. And on this particular day, he needed urgent medical assistance. Unfortunately, the standard procedures within the ambulance service were not followed, and sadly there was a tragic outcome for the Gohan family. The family are appealing for all the recommendations in the investigation report to be followed in full so that no other family has to endure a similar tragedy.
We're just relieved that we have received an apology and this ordeal is over. We hope that no other family will have to suffer the way we have suffered, and we love Darren and we miss him very much.
Now, still to come on the 1 o'clock news, calls for all GAA clubs to have a working defibrillator after several life-saving interventions.
The Lotto jackpot is an estimated 9 million euro. The National Lottery. It could be you.
Detail. Attention to detail in our windows ensures quality. Quality is a Danish principle we were founded on. Our craft has evolved, but our values remain the same. Quality matters. Quality is rationale.
Tastes light and refreshing. This is Rockshore.
Get the power to do more with Sky Broadband. From just €35 a month for 12 months. Experience Sky's best ever Wi-Fi with lightning fast speeds. Switch to Sky Broadband. Search Sky 35. Offer ends 1st of April.
At Bank of Ireland, we understand business. We have dedicated teams of relationship managers, experts in every sector, a wide range of business supports, and your financial well-being as our priority. Choose the bank that's here to help you rise to today's business challenges and tomorrow's. We can, we will begin. Bank of Ireland.
Welcome back to the 1 o'clock news. Now, the GAA is today launching a new campaign to ensure that every club in the country has access to a working defibrillator. In the last 3 years alone, 42 lives have been saved by defibrillators located in GAA facilities.
This is Joe Dunn. He has ran over 20 marathons around the world and was never sick in his life until 7 years ago. He was running here in Clonagel Fontenoy's GAA grounds in Ringsend when he collapsed suddenly with a cardiac arrest.
I'm only here because of the fast action of the guys on the ground, the quality of the CPR, the defibrillator and the work that the ambulance services and emergency and Vincent's Hospital did. So,
luckily for him, a defibrillator was available in the GAA clubhouse and Conor Dodd just happened to be there.
If the defibrillator wasn't here, Joe wouldn't be here either, right? The fact that the defibrillator was here, it stopped his heart beating, it started his heart beating again. So, if, as I said, without the defibrillator being here, Joe probably wouldn't be here.
Sean Kelly was 9 years old and playing in the schoolyard in Rush County, Dublin, 4 years ago when he collapsed suddenly with a cardiac arrest.
So I was in the yard and I was running around and I felt like a bit heavy. And then I told my friend and then I just collapsed to the ground.
Luckily enough, his school is on the grounds of St. Moore's GA Club and they had a defibrillator.
Had we not had the defibrillator, this would be a very different story. Sean wouldn't be with us today. That is the only thing that made a difference for Sean on the day. Without that, there was no substitute. No matter what we did, we would not have got Sean with us today.
Shock delivered.
The GAA today launched the Community Heart Programme in an effort to encourage every club in the country to be aware of the value of defibrillators.
Awareness is the first element of it, Marty, and I think there's probably two strands to that around. We know categorically that the GAA-based defibrillator units have been used to save 42 lives over the last number of years. So that's the first thing to highlight the importance of them. And secondly, that clubs themselves have an accessible, a visible and a fully functioning defibrillator unit.
Since the GAA clubs invested in defibrillators many, many years ago, 42 lives have been saved by those wonderful machines. Now this new initiative by the GAA is to make sure that those defibrillators are checked and recharged, or indeed that new defibrillators are bought with new advancements. Marty Morris, RT News, St. Moore's GAA Club in Rush, County Dublin.
Now over to Petula for all the business news. Petula.
Thanks, Eileen. Good afternoon. Relocating Dublin Port to a new greenfield site would take 20 years and would cost over €8 billion. Dublin Port Company is opposed to moving the port completely from its current location. It has set out options for delivering additional capacity as part of a consultation process.
Dublin Port is likely to reach maximum capacity on the docklands between 2030 and 2040. Additional port capacity will be needed. But the Dublin Port Company does not want to move from this location. Analysis by the company found that it would be unlikely to get planning permission on a new greenfield site, even if it did relocate. The conclusions are contained in papers published by the company as part of a dialogue on how to resolve the port's capacity challenges after 2040. One option suggested a supplementary port could be developed at Bremore near Balbriggan in North Dublin or Arklow in Wicklow. This would reduce congestion in the city while unlocking a significant parcel of land for housing and commercial development in the Docklands area. Construction would have to start on such a project by 2033 if it's to be operational by 2040.
Cineworld is to reopen its cinemas in the US next month and its UK cinemas in May after prolonged shutdowns during the COVID pandemic. It's the world's second biggest cinema group with a large multi-screen outlet in Dublin. The group said last year that there was no truth in rumours that its Dublin outlet would not reopen after the pandemic. Samsung Electronics has agreed a deal with Manna to launch a drone delivery service of its Galaxy devices to Irish customers. The new service is a first for Samsung globally. Manna uses custom-developed aerospace-grade drones to deliver products directly to customers' homes. The service will be made available first to customers based in Oranmore in County Galway. Twitter founder Jack Dorsey's first ever tweet has been sold for $2.9 million to a businessman in Malaysia. The tweet said, "Just setting up my Twitter." It was first published on the platform on March 21st, 2006. The tweet was bought using the cryptocurrency Ether, a rival to Bitcoin. The proceeds of the sale will go to charity. Let's take a look at the markets this lunchtime. The ISAC 20 index is 0.1% higher. Kerry Group and Kingspan gained. Ryanair and Unifar are both lower. In London, the FTSE index is down 0.2%, while the DAX in Frankfurt is marginally lower. The CAC in Paris is down 0.3%, while Tokyo's Nikkei index closed 0.6% lower. On the currencies, the euro buys just over 86 pence sterling and one US dollar and 18.8 cents. And that's the business news for now. Back to you, Eileen.
Thank you very much, Petula. A look at some sports news now, and Ireland boss Stephen Kenny has confirmed that Bournemouth keeper Mark Travers will start against Serbia in Ireland's opening World Cup qualifier tomorrow night. The squad will train later today in Belgrade, with Travers replacing the injured Darren Randolph. Ireland haven't qualified for a World Cup since 2002, and though Kenny concedes the task won't be easy, he's looking forward to the new campaign.
Some of the players, Troy Parrott and Gavin Bazuna, were born in the same year as we last got to the World Cup. And then obviously you have players that who are, you know, 30 years of age and 31 who know that, you know, they really want to give it everything. So we're just really not just looking at the big picture at the minute. We've got to focus on the short term and the task at hand and facing Serbia.
A look at the main news again this lunchtime. The Minister for Health has said the mandatory quarantine system will act as a deterrent against foreign travel into this country. From Friday morning, anyone travelling into Ireland from 33 at-risk countries must pre-book and prepay their accommodation. However, critics of the scheme say it doesn't go far enough. And you can keep up to date with that story and all of the news on the RTE News app. And that is Tuesday's 1 o'clock news. From all the team, good afternoon.
And this evening, heavy showers will give way to settled conditions.
Hello there. Well, by the end of the week, our weather isn't looking too great. In fact, it's going to get cold by Friday with isolated thunderstorms, widespread blustery showers and even the risk of hail. Now, you can see it here on the chart that high pressure is losing its grip as it pulls away over the next few days. So that's going to set in motion a much cooler westerly airflow. For today, though, we're in a southwesterly and it's fresh to strong. You can also see a lot of cloud building in off the Atlantic there with that front that's been moving in quite gradually, just taking hold through the west and indeed the western half of the country during the afternoon. It will continue to track its way eastwards, but becoming a lot patchier in nature, that rain, as it moves eastwards too. So just a few showers in behind it for this evening for western parts. Between now and then, temperatures 10 to 13 degrees Celsius in a southwesterly that will be fresh to strong. Now it will lighten as it veers more westerly for a time, and for tonight, light to moderate southerly winds at play as temperatures come back to between 1 and 5 degrees Celsius. It'll be coldest there under long clear spells with indeed a touch of frost likely in some places. Now a lot of dry and clear weather developing overnight, but still a few showers affecting the west and northwest. Then into tomorrow, a dry and a bright start. Make the most of those sunny spells early on because it's going to be much cloudier for the afternoon. That cloud and rain pushing in off the Atlantic, much like actually what we're seeing for today, becoming a lot patchier as it drifts further eastwards too, with temperatures of 9 to 12 degrees Celsius. Now that's in a southwesterly that will be fresh for tomorrow, and a moderate to fresh then for a Thursday. Some blustery showers in the mix there for Thursday, even the risk of hail, and we end the week on a much colder note, 3 to 7 degrees Celsius your afternoon highs, with a raw westerly wind that's going to be fresh to even strong at times too. Plenty of blustery heavy showers, even the risk of hail, and indeed some isolated thunderstorms. More details on rte.ie/weather for now. Bye bye.
New Avonmore Fresh Dessert Cream. Luxuriously thick and ready to pour. Perfect for sumptuous desserts.
Hi, boys.
That was lovely.
Perfect.
What did she do?
This was padlocked.
She had issues.
I got her help.
Did you see she had it in her?
No.
Is everything you said here a lie?
Deadwater Fell starts March 31st on RTE1 and RTE Player.
For me, Bio Oil Dry Skin Gel is a game changer. It's packed with highly effective moisturising ingredients. I use it every day. Not surprising, really, when I use Bio.